inward infraction, I'll say it that way, in his life, but we want to understand how does that work? Why is that? We find sometimes we find this inconsistency in our walk with God and our thought with God. And why is it some days we seem to love him more than other days? And why is there time we want to praise him more than other times? And so when we look at those times that our earnest and eagerness is not to where it should be, why is that occurring? What does the Bible say that occurs? Tonight we're going to look at some very interesting things Word in the book of Romans chapter 7 and beginning with the 5th verse.
For when we were in the flesh, the motions of sins, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth.
As he reads that, I want you to think about this. The word flesh in the Bible does not mean the same everywhere it appears. And if we think it does, then we're going to be misinformed in scripture when God is speaking about the flesh. So the word flesh in the Bible does not have the same meaning. It's the same word, but it does not have the same meaning of it. You have to, we're going to show you tonight how to go into that word and break out the meaning when you use the word flesh. So go back and read it again, please.
For when we were in the flesh.
So when we were in the flesh, I'm going to stop right there and ask you a question. Do you think he means in the flesh, in the body? Or does he mean flesh concerning something else? Read it.
For when we were in the flesh, the motions of sins, which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit.
Bring this interesting point to you. He said, well, in the flesh, the motions of sins, and the only way that the motions of sins were revealed is how we acted out in the flesh body. That's what he's talking about, the motions of sins. We were in the flesh, but when he says we were in the flesh, he's not talking about the flesh body that functioned in the motion. Talking about another flesh that controlled the flesh body to move in those motions. Man, read.
Which were by the law.
Which were by the law.
Did work in our members.
Did work in our physical body, in our members. Okay? Now, the law was good, but the law was an identifier. And when the law identified, it now brought the flesh to a point or to a place that it would fall short of it. Because it couldn't fall short of what you did not know. It's only in the law that you know what it was that now presents you the, presents you the point of falling victim to the law. If you didn't know what the law was, you wouldn't know how to break it, or you wouldn't even know it's broken, right? So when God gave the law, he gave the law to help people come in more in line with him, but the law really worked against them. Because now they know what right is, and now they're struggling within their flesh. And we're talking about this. They struggled in their flesh to keep it. But they wouldn't struggle in their flesh if they didn't know what to keep. Make sense? So, when you read in the scripture, it said that the law could not do, didn't have the power to do, that it was weak in the flesh to perform it. But the flesh did not have to perform the law until it found out what the law was. See? Let me use the simple Bible here, your time. The law says up to the stop sign, stop. But the best stop sign was there and you ran all around the corner. You didn't know what that law was. No. So if the preacher produced it, you did not stop. You can say, I didn't have to stop because there was nothing there telling me to stop.
Right.
See that? So when the law was given and God gave the law, man was told that God gave the law to give him a guidance what to do. But the law works against them because they didn't have the power to do it within themselves. You understand that? Okay, read.
Which were by the law, did work in our members to bring forth fruit unto death.
Okay, when the law said, thou shalt not, then you continue that. They did not know what thou shalt not be until it was identified. And when it was identified that thou shalt not, now it becomes an obligation or a duty to obey. But the obligation to do to your man was in the power of the people to be able to do it. That's why I said the law was weak through the flesh. The law said the right thing to do, but the flesh was weak to perform it. And we struggle with that today. Even now, we struggle with that. What the Bible said to do, but the flesh seems too weak to perform it, not able to perform it. And so we said now, because of that, it can put you in a place of condemnation. But it should not put you in condemnation because you're trying to obey a law that you don't have the power to obey. So does it say that the law makes us sin? No. God forbid. The law is there to help us to do corrective measures. But the key thing is, do you have the spiritual ability and power and the spiritual mentality to actually perform those abilities?
Right. Huh?
Making sense? And we're going to get deeper into this word. Read on.
Verse 6. But now we are delivered from the law.
If I was given it, then why am I delivered from it? If I was given it to do it, but then I'm delivered not to do it, delivered from it, is that what you think that's what he's saying? Now you're delivered from the law. That means you are now in Christ Jesus, delivered from the power that the law had over you. You're delivered from the power that why? Because now the power of Christ inside of you causes you to live it. Huh? Read.
That being dead, wherein we were held, that we should serve in newness of spirit.
There it is. That we should serve in the newness of the spirit.
And not in the oldness of the letter.
And not in the oldness of the letter. Not in the oldness of the letter. Now, you understand what it said? In the newness of the Spirit. Now, the Spirit of Christ that comes as a new spirit. We should, now he's saying by the newness of the Spirit, we now have the power to live up to the law. But of ourselves and our flesh, you can't do it. You can't do it. Because the reason you can't do it because in one aspect, your flesh, but the law is spiritual. So you can't do it in the flesh trying to do it something in the spiritual. It's got to be spiritual to spiritual. You can't take your flesh and body of the flesh and live a spiritual law because it doesn't compute. It won't work. It's spirit to spirit. Got it? So now the Spirit of Christ is out of us now causes us to live the spirit of the law. Make sense? Read.
What shall we say then?
What shall we say then?
Is the law sin? God is.
See, it's the law of sin because we in the flesh can't keep it. No. The law of God is God's law. He gave a law to Moses on the Ten Commandments and brought it down the mountain, and the people couldn't live it. They didn't have the power in their flesh to live it. And so he had to give them a way of living it. He had to give them a way to equip them to be able to live what he gave them. What verse is
that? I'm in verse 7.
Okay, read.
God forbid.
God forbid.
Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law.
See, I would not have known what sin was until the law identified what was right. So when the law identified what was right, the opposite of right was the sin. But because I couldn't keep the law, I done the opposite, a sin. And that's where you hear Paul having the struggle that's going on inside of him, because he and Billy are talking to us out of the flesh realm, trying to do something spiritual. And he said, the things I would not do, I do. The things that I should do, I don't do. So he's got a warring in the flesh, trying to do spiritual things from a spiritual mind. Okay? Read. Is that all seven?
No, sir.
Okay?
For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet.
I did not even know what a lust was until the law identified it. So when the law identified lust, then lust became a subjection to me to lust. Because I didn't know what it was until the law identified it. So then, if I did not know what lust was until the law identified it, then why am I drawn to that? Why is it seem so easily prone to be drawn to something that disobeys the law of God? We're going to find out in Scripture why this is. We're going to break that down and tell you why it is. Is that all that verse?
That's all verse.
Okay, now go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 16.
For which cause we faint not. But though our outward man perish.
Yes.
Yet
now, when he talks about outward man perishing, that's got to be the body, right? Because this outward man, the flesh, is constantly perishing every day. But what does he say about the inward?
Is renewed day by day.
The inward is renewed. So that means, since the inward spirit is renewed, the inward spirit is more powerful than the outward flesh. Because the outward flesh dies, but the spirit is renewed. So it tells you that what's on the inside of you is more powerful than what you operate on the outside of you. Read.
Verse 17. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment.
Now we sense affliction through the physical, right? We feel it through the physical. We know we are going through afflictions mentally, whatever, but it's basically felt through the physical. Read, light affliction or what?
But for a moment.
But for a moment. But what's happening?
Working for us a far more exceeding.
So, since it's working for us, there's got to be something in us that makes it work for us. Got it? And that's the Spirit of Christ in us to make it work for us. A what?
A far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory.
So that means that the light of friction and the Holy Spirit that works in us, goes beyond just the flesh, but it goes even into the spirit where it works for a far more exceedingly eternal weight of glory. So in other words, the Spirit of Christ exposes your flesh man to another dimension. Got it? All right. Go back to Romans 7 and pick up verse 8.
But sin, taking occasion by the commandment, wrought in me all manner of concupiscence.
Now, my question is this. Go back and write this down and see what he said. Read.
But sin, takes the occasion by the commandment.
Okay. Sin takes the occasion. Sin takes what exists, takes the occasion. Sin steps up and presents itself as though there's nothing else you can do to sin. It takes the occasion. That is the denominator of the occasion. Got it? Read.
Taking occasion by the commandment.
By the commandment, because the commandment was the identifier. Mm-hmm. And then when he used concupiscence, he's talking about the mind. Read.
Wrought in me. All manner of concupiscence.
All manner of mindly thinking. When you use concupiscence to talk about the mind, all manner of mindly thinking causes the law to somewhat control us or take advantage of the occasion. That's why the Bible says we've got to be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that the mind does not take advantage of the occasion of the sin that is presented.
Amen.
Got that? Is that clear? Read.
Without the law, sin was dead.
Now, without the law, sin had no opportunity or had an occasion to activate itself. The only way that sin could have an occasion to activate itself, it had to now be revealed what that sin is. And once that sin will reveal what it is, then there's something inside of us that actually attracts itself to the activation of the sin. Mm-hmm. Even the believer. Mm-hmm. That thing, baby. And we're going to break that down and show you how that works, how that takes place. He said that sin, the law said, what it said, it brought in me all the manner of desire in my mind, or in my imagination. But for it to develop in my mind or imagination, there has to be something there that is compatible in me to make that happen. There has to be something there. Yeah, but I'm saying that there's still something there that makes that compatible or conducive for us to be pushed or pressured, trying to do the right thing, but pressured to do the wrong thing. We're going to find out what that is in Scripture. For the law spoken triggered the desire to break it. For the law, let me say it again, spoken of the law shown triggered the desire to break it. And use the stop sign situation. The law shown of the stop sign triggers us to do a roll stop. We don't stop, we just roll around the sign slowly and slowly. You didn't stop, you just roll slowly around. But there was something inside you said, I can get away with that. I don't have to stop. I'll just walk real close and take my time to go around. But you just only looked, you didn't stop.
Right.
See how easily that happens? Well, why did that so easily happen to us? Because I'm sure you know that there's something inside of us that triggers us to try to get away. with the law, didn't I? Wow. Go to the book of Romans. We're in the 7th chapter. Go down to verse 18.
For I knew that in me.
Now watch this. For I knew that in me. I know there's something in me. I know there's something in me. I may not be able to identify what it is, but I know it's in me. Because it's in there making me respond the way I'm responding. It's in there. Many times it's in there. We don't know what it is. We have no idea. But I'm going to show you the scripture what it is. Read.
That is in my flesh.
In my flesh. This thing is in my flesh. Huh?
Dwelleth no good thing.
Does what?
Dwelleth no good thing.
So if it's in there and dwells no good thing, then how come? Then it stands to reason why it seems like there's a trigger to disobey the law once you know what it is. Because it's something in the flesh that is no good. Right. But we're going to find out what it is and how it got in there. Wow. Read.
For to will is present with
you. For will is present. And most of that will is in your mind. That will is present to do it, what?
But how to perform that which is good.
But how to perform that which is good, what?
To perform that which is good, I find not.
I don't find how to perform that which is good, but the will is to do good, but I can't find out how to do it. For I find what verse you have to give me.
That's the end of verse 18.
Okay. Then read 19.
For the good that I would.
The good I would.
I do not.
The good that I wish. And we do a lot of wishing to do good. The good that I would. What?
I do not.
I do not. What?
But the evil which I would not, that I do.
So why is it seemingly so easy to not do the good than it is to do the good? What is that controlling factor inside of us that makes us struggle more with doing good than when it seems so easy to do bad? Am I talking less than that? Does this make sense? Do you kind of see your life just kind of doing that day in, day out? They ain't calling you from God. They ain't calling you not saved. Huh? But it's a reality. And we can understand the essence of what that is, or the detail of what that is. Because when we get a better understanding, we will now know how to submit to make it easier to do good than it does to do bad. Because we're going to find the scripture what controls that. Read.
Verse 20. Now if I do that I would not, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me.
Oh, now watch this. Watch this. Who's saying this? Paul? Saying this? Was he not an apostle? Was he not an apostle of the church? But then he says, even with me, he says that sin that dwells in me. Sin that dwells in me. So we're going to learn tonight where the me is. Inside of us as believers, where the me houses itself. Read.
Now if I do that, I would not. It is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me.
21.
I find then a law.
There it is. Now I find the law. And the law is what? There's an identifier inside of me. And what's inside of me that identifies the law cripples me to not do the law. Read.
I find then a law that when I would do good,
when I would do good,
evil is present with me.
Evil is present with me. So you know what that's telling us? When I want to do good, evil is present with me. So what's in me that feeds that evil place? What's in me that does that? There's something there. Huh? Wow. Read.
For I delight in the law, of God, after the inward man.
After the inward man. Now, when he's speaking of the inward man, he's talking about the inward man who has accepted Christ. So the inward man that has accepted Christ, he delights in the law. And that inward man, I'm going to put this out right now so we can lead into it, but the inward man that delights in the law is the spirit man of Christ. For I delight in the law of God after the spirit inward man. But read.
But I see another law in my members.
Now look at that. He said, I got the inward man that delights in the law, but I got another one in there. Is that what the Bible said? See what he said? I find in the law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inner man. But I see another law. What?
In my members.
In my members.
Warring against the law
so
of my mind.
That means there is two warring laws. See, there's two warring laws. All of us in this room tonight have two warring laws. Warring against what?
Warring against the law of my mind.
My mind,
And bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members.
Yes. And then what he says in 24, we'll move on from there.
O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death?
He's asking me a very profound question. He said, I know it's there. I don't understand it, but I know it's there. Who's going to deliver me from this warring? Who's going to deliver me from this pressure that I deal with? Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? What's he saying, 25?
I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Now, he gives the answer. I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord, which we have in us. Right? Read.
So then with the mind, I myself serve the law of God.
With the mind, and that mind is alluding to the fallen nature mind. So then with the mind that keeps me struggling, I now serve the law of God. Read.
But with the flesh, the law of sin.
With the flesh, the law of sin. I go to the 8th chapter and the 3rd verse.
For what the law could not do.
The law could not do.
In that it was weak through the flesh.
So you got that already, right? Read.
God sending his own son.
God sending his own son.
In the likeness of sinful flesh.
Yes.
For sin. Condemned sin in the flesh.
Now, we're going to come back to this. Here, it's going to be a two-part teaching. But we're going to come back to this, and I'm going to ask you. use some very nine piercing investigating questions. It's going to make you stretch your mind and think. And we're going to show you in truth the clarity of it. We're going to get to that. But here's what I want you to. He said, because in my flesh dwells a good thing. The flesh, listen, is the fallen nature. And a corrupt nature. But when God created us, we was not created in the fallen nature. Huh? We were not created with a fallen nature. Go back to Genesis and then we'll take the time to break this out. Go back to Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, 28.
So God created man in his own image.
Now, did God have a fallen nature? No. He said, I created man in my what?
In his own image.
In his own image.
In the image of God created.
In the image of God created.
He, him.
Uh-huh. So then, since we were not created with this fallen nature, where did we get it? Where did it originate from? Go to the third chapter of the book of Genesis and the sixth verse.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food,
uh-huh,
and that it was pleasant to the eyes,
yes,
and a tree to be desired to make one wise,
yes,
she took of the fruit thereof.
See, right there when she took the fruit, that was disobedience. And the law had already told her, don't disobey and eat the fruit. Huh? But when she saw the fruit, it triggered her. Huh? And when she took up the fruit, the divine nature of God now is switched to a fallen nature at that point. Huh? And the fallen nature is what haunts us day in and day out. We're not subjects of the fallen nature, but we're constantly subjected to the fallen nature. Go to St. John 1 and 3.
All things were made by him.
Uh-huh.
And without him was not anything made that was made.
Since he said all things were made by him, did he make fallen nature? No, he didn't. Because if he made fallen nature, then there would be no need to try to save us from it when he made it for us. He didn't make fallen nature. Everything in nature he said was good. And fallen nature never came into existence until Adam and Eve disobeyed. Huh? And the reason why this is important to understand, that makes us, when we get into this part of scripture, we don't have a high priest that cannot sympathize with the things we go through. Hmm? We're going to break that down. Put this question to you, just kind of wet your mind. I'm going to put this question to you. Then, since Jesus said he came in the likeness of sinful nature, did he have a sinful nature? When it said he came in the likeness of sinful nature, I'm just going to pause right. Come back and answer. Wow. The flesh is a compulsive inner force inherited from man's fall. When God created man, it's only a physical being, flesh, physical flesh. Not a flesh that is called fallen nature that only came when the man disobeyed. You're clear? The fallen flesh body is compulsive in its sin nature. It is compulsive. It gets the heartbeat from it. It gets the drive from it. The flesh and the spirit are two opposing forces. And now we know in the book of Genesis, chapter 3, and in the book of Genesis, chapter 1, that the two opposing forces happened after chapter 3. Because before that, there was no opposing force. Go to Galatians 5:17. Let me get something out of this. Galatians 5:17.
Wherefore be ye not unwise, but understanding what the will of the Lord is.
Understanding what the will of the Lord is. Come on.
And be not drunk with wine, wherein is excess.
Yes.
But be filled with the Spirit. Verse 19, speak to yourself.
Did you read 17 or 18?
17 and 18.
Okay, this 17 is fine here. Go back to the book of Romans chapter 7 and verse 23. I want to go over that verse again and give us a little more clarity on this. Read 17, 23 Romans.
But I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind, and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin, which is in my members.
Yes.
Verse 24.
Now, that's part of that. I'm going to ask you a question. In this verse, do you think it's alluding to the flesh of the physical body or the flesh of the fallen nature? Read the verse again. I want you to, even if you respond to the law, I want you to understand. Read.
But I see another law in my members.
I see another law in my members.
Warring against the law of my mind.
Now, watch this. Listen closely. I see another law in my members.
Warring against the law of my mind.
I see a law in the members of my flesh operating or concurring with that. That's working against the law of my spiritual mind. See what Paul is saying here? Read.
And bringing me into captivity.
And it brings me into captivity. So why can it bring us into captivity? Is because we are more prone to yield to the fallen nature instead of the new nature. And we're more prone to fall to the fallen nature because there's something that identified, like a law, to say, don't do that. And then it seems like it's more easy to do it than don't do it. Come on, huh? Yeah, don't do that. But it seems like it's more easy to do it than don't do it. So we got to understand, what is that war? What is that? And it almost seems like it's not even a pull. It just happened, you know, it just, come on, right? So then we got to look at, then what is it in us that makes us get in so easily to it? Because once the sin is identified, it stirs up the fallen nature. Huh? And that's why it was so easy for Adam and Eve to go and eat that fruit. Huh? Because the Lord had already been identified. Right? Where are we at? Romans 7:23.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Did you finish all 23?
Yes, sir.
All right, read it.
Warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity to the law of sin,
and brings me into captivity to the law of sin. Read.
Into the law of sin, which is in my members.
In my members. So you got to understand, if you're talking about the members of flesh, or if you're talking about of the fallen flesh nature. You have to understand the difference because it gives you a clear understanding how this works. Is it all verse 23?
Yes, sir.
Romans chapter 2, verse 28. I'm about to do part 2 on this. I hate God's presentation. It's fascinating. But see, it is easy for a preacher to stand by and start saying, need you this, need you this, that. But if you don't understand why you're doing what you're doing, huh? You will constantly be in bondage if you don't get some type of instruction of what you're dealing with and why you deal with it and how to come out of it. That's the same thing the children dealt with Moses. Huh? Until they got a knowledge of what was causing, they didn't have the power to get out of it, didn't know how to get out of it, and it just causes trouble. Right? And we believe we do that today, because we did, we have not gotten a full understanding. What you're receiving tonight is so profound. Is to give you a clear view of the different natures that work inside of you, what calls what nature, and why a certain nature responds to what it responds to, and then what we have access to us to give us the ability to overcome that fallen nature. Romans 2:28.
For he is not a Jew, which is one outwardly.
Now look at this. Now, the law said to be identified as a Jew, the male boys had to be circumcised. That's what the law said. But read on what it says here.
Neither is that circumcision which is outward in the flesh.
See, that outward circumcision in the flesh did not make the Jews any more special than anybody else. They were just following a law, got circumcised, but they couldn't follow other laws after circumcision. It was more outwardly still than inwardly. And that's why you can't do works for people to look on the outside. Give a list of do's and don'ts out of preference. You got to give it out of revelation of God. Amen. God, revelation will tell you exactly what to do and not to do. And ain't got to do with our preference. It's got to do with his will.
Right.
Because when I come, we'll try to build the church off of what we prefer, and we want the church to look like what we feel we're going to look like. But we found out last night that the church of Jesus Christ had a lot of mess in it. Liars, cheaters, and he had them on the payroll. But we'll say, a minute, it's my church, you didn't know me, no. That's it, that's your church, it ain't God's church. Because when you go back and look at the 12 disciples and you look at that as Church of Jesus Christ, he had a bunch of guys that were messy.
That's right.
Huh? Real messy. But he did not turn away. As a matter of fact, he didn't even expose them. He didn't even expose. He didn't even expose Judas as a traitor. He didn't even expose Peter as a hothead. He just personally went to Peter and said, Satan desires to send you weak, but I'm praying for you, because this is going to happen. And then he goes, and he goes to Judas and tells Judas incognito, like directly to him, but everybody else hears it, but they don't recognize it. So he never draws any attention to Judas the traitor. But Judas knew he was a traitor because Jesus dressed as a traitor. See what I'm saying? And we have a total misconception of what the church ought to be. Total. A lot of that comes from old background church ethic. That's why people say, can I come to your church dressed like this? Well, I think that's the same question. Because they got a lot of wrong attitude. You don't think Jesus can say your intentions? The Lord is not impressed with my sins and outwards. He's impressed with what's on the inside of the sin. Huh? He don't care if I've got matching shirts and ties and couplings and all that. Because he didn't come and save my time. Come on. Sometimes we place too much emphasis on the wrong thing. Because he said, love and kindness have I promised. All right? And that's why we need to know the word, so we do not get ourselves in condemnation because people say certain things and think that's said. Is that all? Verse 28?
Yes, sir.
Go to 1 John, the 4th chapter and the 2nd verse. First John, chapter 4, verse 2.
Hereby know ye the Spirit of God.
Everybody know the Spirit of God.
Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh,
yes,
is of God.
Now, watch this. Every spirit that confesseth that Jesus came in the flesh body is of God. Read.
Verse 3. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God.
Is not of God. So why is he so specific about wanting us to know that Jesus came in the flesh body? Why is that so significant? It's significant to us to show us that Jesus is relative to us who were born in the flesh body. That, in other words, since Jesus was born in the flesh body, you in the flesh body, you have accessibility to Jesus. And that accessibility that you have to Jesus makes you accessible to the Son of the living God. And everything that the kingdom has to offer. Huh? God was not God's intention to send Jesus down here as God. Because man could not ever come up to reach the place that God was. He had to bring him to a man's state so we could reach God through Jesus Christ. Is that all one, two?
Verse 3, no, sir.
Just 2. 4 and 2.
I've read all of 2.
Yes. Okay, thank you so much. The flesh is not willing to depend on anyone or anything outside of its own power or control. Jesus Christ had a human nature. That means that he possessed the right of being the Son of Man. All of it. But not the right of being the Son of God. Did y'all catch that? Or repeat that? Let me repeat that. Christ had a human nature that possessed the right of being the Son of Man, being fallen, but not the right to be the Son of God, sinful. We no longer have the old sinful nature, but are given a pure, holy, and righteous spirit of man, Jesus Christ, within us. That's why the Bible said, greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Yet we still have a mind. Still have a mind. And a body that still deals with temptations and sin. Amen? We have the great one in us, but we still have a mind and a body that still deals with temptation and sin. Let's go back to scripture proof. Was not Jesus the Son of God sent into the wilderness, but he was in the Son of Man body? Was he not tempted? Was he not subjected, as a matter of fact, back to the Spirit led him, and one passage of the Spirit drove him into the wilderness to be confronted with temptation because he knew we would be the same way. Sometimes you are driven into situations for you to be tempted. Why? Why does he do that? So that you now rely back on the Word of God. Do y'all know that? He said, temptation is not sin. God tempts no man to sin. But he will tempt the man to recognize who God is in your life, so they can have a stronger relationship with God. Got it? It says, send not to temptation, right? So did it say that God sent Jesus in order to be tempted by the devil? So what was the purpose of that temptation? It was for Jesus to reveal to us that even though temptation may come to your word, you have something inside of you to counteract that and have deliverance over. And it's nothing more than the written word of God. Amen? I'm going to read another scripture and close it. I'm going to pick this up tomorrow and finish this out. And we're going to make some powerful themes here. Go to 2 Corinthians 5, 16, and 17.
Wherefore, henceforth, know we no man after the flesh. Yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh.
Come on now, you know what he said? He said, know Christ after the flesh. What don't I know Christ after a fallen sinful nature? Knowing man after
Yet now henceforth we know him no more. Verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature.
He's a new creature.
Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new.
Now, verse 16, where it says flesh, is talking about the human body, not the fallen nature. Flesh. Now, go back up to verse 15 of the same chapter.
And that he died for all, that they which should live should not henceforth live unto themselves.
Now, when he died and had to be a flesh body, because his spirit couldn't die. So when he died in the flesh body, this is so miraculous to me. When he died in the flesh body, there was something that supernaturally took place in the spirit realm that has given back to us what we need or should have to be his children. He had to die the physical death to release us from the physical of where the sin nature lived or resided. So when he died, he released us from that death of the sin flesh nature that is in us. Wow, that's deep. So he had to die physical death to overcome the fall that happened back in Genesis. Because the fall was operating out of the flesh of Adam and Eve. He says, so let me die in the flesh to overcome the fall that created the sin nature that it can live in the flesh. That's awesome. That is awesome. Read verse 15. I'm closing.
That he died for all.
He died for all.
That they which lived.
That they which lived.
Should not henceforth.
Should not henceforth.
Live unto themselves.
Live unto themselves, which was the fallen nature. Because Adam and Eve started living unto themselves and they are in the fallen nature because they wanted to live unto themselves. Have the right to disobey God. They want to live unto themselves. And the fallen nature is the nature that is the driving force. And Paul was talking about things I wouldn't do, I do. Things I wish not to do, I do. Things I ought to do and don't do. Then he says, oh, wretched man that I am. Oh, wretched fallen nature that still yet influences me. Who's going to deliver me? Well, the Jesus that died is going to deliver me.
Amen.
The Jesus that lives inside me is going to deliver me.
Amen. Thank
you. He said, who's going to deliver me from this? Rich man. He said, who's going to deliver me from this death? He said, because the fallen nature of a man in the flesh, it is spiritual death to us.
Amen.
He said, who's going to deliver me? He said, thanks be to God through our Lord Jesus Christ, who died in the flesh, went into death, dominated the fallen nature of death or sin. Overcame it and will give me the victory if I apply my faith and my willingness to him.
Amen.
See how that works? Just how that works? So even with the struggles that you deal with, there is is a way out. Oh my goodness. Well, I don't think apostles coming up, but this is a word. This is a word. You know, I thank God for it, because it said, this said if somebody was in here was not believing, was not saved, they would have a clear understanding of how this could work in their lives. Because those that are getting sin, we struggle with it, but they struggle with it more because they don't have enough control for it.
That's right. Amen.
And they're looking at, how can I ever overcome this and not do this? But we have an inkling of what can cause us to overcome, but when they have nothing there, they have no hope to draw from. So you got to give them a word of hope that they can draw from, that I can do this.
Amen.
Amen. And I'm giving you a word tonight to let you know, not only can you do this, but you will do this.
That's right. Sure will.
Because I'm telling you right now, the Holy Spirit is going to haunt you. It's going to be on your occasion to you submit and say, yes. He said, because I would that not perish. We're going to see the consummation scene tonight. God, I thank you for your word in this place.
For the word in this place.